and their inmates and those who might be there. But it takes place mostly in America's streets, in the community, in the home. It's about children in trouble. It could be your children. If it can be said that criminals are made in the community, it is also true that they are schooled in prison. Eventually, almost every prison inmate is returned to the community. But how well is the public protected? And how well is the ex-convict reformed?
We have done nothing in prison but create criminals. It's simple. You have limited resources. You make men bitter. You make them hateful.
We hustled. We gambled. Guys stole from each other to pay off other guys or sold the goods to other inmates. You know, it was just crime.
In here, you know, you're an animal. You get treated like one, and you have to act like one. You know, because if another screw doesn't get you, it's possibly another inmate will. So you don't learn to be kind. You don't learn to be generous and compassionate. You know, you learn to survive.
If any lesson has been learned from the prison system in the last 100 years, it is that rehabilitation of criminals cannot be mass-produced. Society has now reached the point where it must choose. Do we want retribution, revenge for crimes committed by the offender? Or can we accept the criminal as someone not less than human and make real efforts at bringing him back into the society of man? This is the story of a bold new approach in the field of corrections, where the rehabilitation process is moved from the prison to the community, to the home, to the streets. The entrance into the criminal justice system in any state begins with the arrest. In some states, a juvenile offender is first brought to the county juvenile hall. This is Juvenile Center, Sacramento County, California. For many, this is the first turn of the revolving doorway to a life of institutionalization, from juvenile hall to training school to reformatory to state penitentiary. Chief Probation Officer Warren Thornton.
A real devastating experience to any young man to have a policeman bring him through that door. And in California, we may be unique in some manner. We have intake probation officers, about 20 of them here, that are around the clock. And their job is to do nothing but whenever a child is brought through that door there, he immediately tries to make a decision. Is there any other possible alternative than to keep that child here?
Many California counties are cutting down the number of juvenile commitments. State Director of Corrections, Raymond Procunier.
It's my advice, anyone that has a child in difficulty, if it's at all possible, they sell their home and borrow all the money they can to get adequate care for him, to protect society at the same time not having to become institutionalized, is the best solution to the problem.
But for those who don't make it, the stigma of imprisonment begins here, and for many, follows them through life. This is Preston School of Industry in Ione, California, a prison for young men. Despite the externally pleasant surroundings in some of these places, the process of deterioration sets in. Preston once housed 800 young men from the ages of 17 to 24. It now has less than 500, evidence of California's attempt to reduce juvenile commitments. This is Preston's maximum security unit. The great contradiction of our prison system is the attempt to punish and reform at the same time. It has repeatedly failed for over 100 years.
They treat you like a separate animal, man. You're not even a human being.
I've been here since December 70. When I first came here, it kind of shocked me, the place. You know, I figured, well, I guess I got time to do, so I might as well make it beneficial to me.
They go to school or a trade, and they spend their time, free time, here in this area. There is a potential problem whenever you congregate more than two people together, because you're going to have a difference of opinion.
They teach you how to lie and how to cheat. You learn to manipulate the system in order to get out. In order to get out, you have to tell them that you're rehabilitated and that you'll never do it again. And you got to convince your counselor or whoever you're talking to that this is for real.
You won't go to board March 6th. You're not going to board until April.
Why?
Because that's the date that you were told at the last board hearing.
No, but I'm going to superintendent's review anyway.
No, you won't go to superintendent's review.
Why not? I already asked them.
We're not taking you.
Massachusetts Director of Youth Services, Dr. Jerome Miller.
This whole system of training schools nationally, and most states depend on them, is born and bred in violence. And no matter how you dress it up, no matter how you put it in new buildings, no matter how many programs you infuse into it, or how many psychiatric consultants you parade through it, it's still based in violence and repressiveness, and there's no way you can get around it. Because somewhere, every one of them, in some corner, there's a place that handles the deviance of that system. And usually it's a fairly brutal place. If not actually physically brutalizing, it's psychologically brutalizing. And the whole system's held together by that.
This is the juvenile prison at Bridgewater, Massachusetts, a walled maximum security center for the most difficult and so-called dangerous young offenders in the state. In operation for over a century, now abandoned. In the 2 years since Dr. Miller took office as Youth Corrections Director, all five state-run juvenile institutions have been closed. Although many states are considering such actions, Massachusetts has gone further than any in phasing out correctional institutions for young people.
We can't talk about changing the system because basically the system's based on a lot of hypocrisy. We can't any longer call a jail a correctional facility because it doesn't correct. And until we can say it does, we shouldn't call it that. We'd be better off to call it a repressive old jail that we lock people up in. That's what it is. This lock is off the Institute for Juvenile Guidance, so-called, at the Bridgewater. When we closed that, we took with us a large number of those locks as kind of a symbol of the change. It represented an approach to corrections that's been with us 100 years or more. It's my feeling that these sorts of institutions generally made matters worse rather than better, and that they haven't guaranteed any semblance of public safety. We're trying to avoid this whole criminalization process, and there are many ways you do this. There are many models you can follow. You can follow a classic child care model. You can follow family service models. You can follow psychiatric models. There are all sorts of them. For instance, group homes, halfway houses, foster homes, volunteer arrangements with youngsters spending time individually with volunteers who spend 2 or 3 days or nights a week with the kid. Living arrangements in dorms at colleges with college students working with them as part of their taking of credit. Living arrangements at YMCAs with the programs that some of the Ys have involved and putting our staff into those programs. Our house in Hyde Park, which was put together on a shoestring in terms of that we had no money for it, no budget. We got a house for $1 a year from the Boston Redevelopment Group that was condemned. And that's how we got our first halfway house. We didn't wait for legislation, and we didn't wait for all sorts of other go-aheads. The youngsters there are there for a wide variety of problems, ranging from drug addiction through a number of other delinquencies. It has a normal household living arrangement. We have a lady, Mrs. Fama, who had worked in one of the institutions as a cook and came there and quickly kind of blossomed into the house mother. Everybody calls her Ma, and I think she's found a whole new life there. They take care of the house themselves. It's very well taken care of. They have a large number of groups during the week, different kinds of groups. Groups around confronting one another, around feelings, around how they're feeling about one another. And very often these feelings are very loaded and deep feelings. It may surprise people to know that kids who are delinquent very often don't know how to handle anger.
Because I'm doing my thing. You're doing sh-
How about being honest, Michael? How about being honest and tell us what you really want?
I want to love people.
That's what you're supposed to say.
I feel that way a lot, so sometimes I don't.
Yeah. And how often do you talk about the sometimes that you don't? Never. Because you might get challenged if you ever talk about it.
The group sessions are guided by trained therapists, House director and psychologist Pat Tagg, and counselor Joan Callahan. The technique is based on using the power of constructive peer group influence to change delinquent behavior.
Yeah, that's what I wanted. Too dope, just enough so it looks good. That's how I feel, like, just do enough so I can stay high or something, so no one else really sees anything.
Why do you want to be a dope fiend, Mike? What's in it for you?
Well, this time around, I'd be dead. I'm sick of you thinking that, you know, because you've been around here for 11 months, there's nothing wrong with you. Sick of you thinking there's nothing wrong with you when there is.
I'm sick of your image. Big, dope fiend image that you got. And you're closed.
When the hell are you going to do it on your own? Because you're a snake right now. I don't trust you at all. And I hate the way that makes me feel inside. I'm just disgusted with you.
When real emotions can be aired, feelings of warmth and friendship emerge, and the boys are encouraged to express themselves freely.
I think everybody was honestly telling Michael how his recent behavior has been making them feel. And I think that should sort of tell Michael what he has to do about himself. Because I think the consequences of that were pointed out to Michael are very real. Michael will end up dead if he doesn't change.
The prison system, as we know it, is an American invention. The concept of locking up the offender, punishing him by depriving him of freedom, was introduced as a more humane way of dealing with criminals by the American Quakers in Philadelphia in the early 1800s, replacing more primitive forms of corporal punishment in common use in America and Europe before that time, such as flogging, the use of the lash, maiming, and torturing. Rehabilitation, it was thought, could be achieved by putting offenders in solitary confinement, forcing them to be penitent, hence the word penitentiary. It was soon discovered that prolonged solitary confinement for the purpose of penitence often led to insanity. But the system persisted, and as attitudes became more punitive, inmates were subjected to the degradations of slave-like labor, striped suits, shaved heads, and the ball and chain. The need for penal reform developed as quickly as new prisons were built. It wasn't until the 1930s that the Elmira system of schooling and vocational training was put into any significant use. In the next 40 years, new practices were introduced. Psychiatric and social services and treatment concepts all have had little effect. Institutions are still run, most experts agree, for their own perpetuation, their bureaucratic administration, jobs for the custodial staff and the treatment staff, and to maintain a sense of security for the public, real or imaginary. Recidivism, which means the rate of return to prison for new crimes after release, is as high as ever, in some places 65% to 85%. To evade or mitigate the deteriorating effects of prison sentences required by law, alternatives were devised. Probation, supervision of the young or first offender in his home or community instead of imprisonment. Parole, release from prison before the termination of sentence, with continued supervision in the community by a parole agent. In California, the main thrust in the drive to reduce prison commitments, especially for youthful offenders, is the development of intensive probation and parole services. This boy's name is Patrick. His friends call him Packy. He is 14 years old. He has been to juvenile court for a series of offenses. He is now on probation. This man's name is Bill Yerong, deputy probation officer, Sacramento County, California. He is 25 years old, a full-time worker in the county probation department, a part-time student at Sacramento State College, where he is working on a master's degree in corrections. Bill Yerong is a part of California's probation subsidy program, an intensive care approach which permits him to work closely with his small caseload. These two are tied together in a special kind of relationship, partly compulsory, but partly based, too, on friendship and good feelings for one another.
But don't look behind you. And see if you can watch the quarterback throw the ball. That way you get a better position here.
When you're a probation officer, you find yourself in a variety of situations. You go into their home, you see them at school, you see them on the streets, and they come into your office. So you supposedly have 40 hours a week to work, but I don't think I could possibly do the kind of job I would feel satisfied with within 40 hours.
There are some who believe that punitive attitudes in our society derived from a misinterpretation of the biblical phrase, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. Some think its true meaning is, if I take your eye, I must see for you. A restitutional rather than a punitive approach.
On the victim, I think there's going to be the restitution of $50. I'll let you know when the restitution is going to be due so you can pay it back.
All right.
You don't have to pay it all back at once. You can pay it back a couple of times a month, you know, depending on when you get paid.
Okay, well.
But that's going to be part of your probation. And I'll let your mother know.
Okay.
Is she aware, too, of the restitution? She should be. I know the judge made it plain at court.
I think she is. Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's the only main thing, because I think you're pretty well set as far as, you know, you got a job, you're attending school, and then you have the classes at City College.
I'm going to push my way out of here, even though I can't say when. I'm going to get off of this dead end street, and I ain't gonna never gonna come back again.
This boy's name is Jerry. His friends call him Popcorn. He is 19 years old. He has served time in three institutions in California's juvenile correctional system. He is now living in a youth authority group home and is on parole. His parole agent, Marvin Bibby, working in a special unit of California's intensive parole program in Sacramento County, supervises a group of young parolees.
Time to time, we get together when there's nothing else to do, holidays and so forth. Go out on an outing and see what happens. Fences here in the group, I guess, run all the way from runaways, beyond controls, no place to go, to some pretty serious offenses, armed robbery, burglaries, strong arms. Possession of narcotics, pretty common part of these young men's repertoire. But they've all been in institutions. They've all been through some kind of program inside. And they're now out on parole. As a parole agent, I'm the authority figure that they have to respond to. That's a part of my role. It's part of a group home director.
Elwood Peterson, a group home supervisor in the special parole unit, is himself an ex-convict.
If somebody messes up on the streets or can't handle it on the streets for one reason or another, I think to put him in an institution is just, you're not doing it where it's taking place at.
I don't feel the joint did me any good.
They never let you think about doing things. They tell you everything to do in an institution. And it gets to the point where you can no longer think. The only thing that you can do is like a robot. Yes, sir. No, sir. Yes, sir. No, sir.
I think the group homes are still somewhat of an institution, but it's more liberal. You know, cats are able to explore some of the things that they feel that they can do. And I kind of feel that the main job of group homes is to let the cat be outside and be able to pursue whatever sort of trade, like Popcorn here, trying to be a musician. You know, he couldn't possibly pursue it in a realistic fashion in an institution.
At one of the group homes, parole agent Marvin Bibby and his house directors discuss some of their objectives.
Essentially, what we were trying to do was to provide a place for people with no place else to go and a way to get them out of the institution and deal with them on an individual basis. I don't care whether you call it a group home, a halfway house, or a residential institution in the community.
My house right now is just like an apartment full of people who are pretty much like me, and none of them do anything incredibly weird, so it's just people. And you get into their minds, and you have to live their lives. You have to get into what they see, how they see the world. When you get close to them that way, almost as a friend, then you begin to work with their minds to help them. I don't do anything different here that I wouldn't do outside, except I do it with people who need so much more understanding. Except every now and then I come down and do, you know, don't do that. It's stupid, you get busted.
It's really not the idea of being busted or not being busted, Jim. It's the idea of being able to handle.
Okay, okay.
The system, the society, you know, to where you don't fall.
Parole agent Bibby will, on occasion, invite his wards to his own home, where he and Mrs. Bibby provide sandwiches and snacks.
Well, they're just people. You know, I have two roles. One is a parole agent, and one is a human being, I guess. They're human beings, and they're no different than anybody else, as I can see. How can I describe them?
The work of getting the offender to better understand himself, the slow and difficult process of learning how to change behavior, goes on even here.
Some people might call us loose because we're not concerned about hair and we're not concerned about dress or language or some of those kinds of things. But we do expect that people learn to be responsible for themselves and to take the responsibility for their own actions.
And if you can get them to see, how much bigger the world is, you know, if you can give them some of your perspective and then get them out of their problems, God, they'd work fantastic. They'd be creative.
And a program just doesn't get it. Every time you design a program, you end up with a theory. If you end up with a theory, then you have to match the kids to make the theory come out.
Right.
A program also doesn't live with a never-ending, 24-hour-a-day, awesome, anxiety-producing crisis. The kid's going to blow it, and he's going to lose him, and the system's going to take him over, and he's going back to jail, and he's going to do a year, and you lost him.
So it's like, it's the two things. It's one is to get a guy doing his acting out, more or less, but also his development and growth. Get out, because the home is only a base. And the other thing is to make sure you have enough control over him so he doesn't go out and burglarize and get into his old street games.
The group house offers a range of activities, for some a chance to develop their talents. The house also can become a constructive focal point for other young people in the community.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Huh?
I'll see you on Monday.
Okay. Yeah, I had another call last night on the noise.
Noise? Well, I told the lady to call us when the noise is real loud, but she'll call you and complain. It goes all the way to the top.
Neighbors, they got a right to live too. Got a right to sleep. About 10 o'clock.
You know, they have to have something to do rather than run out in the street.
All right. I that's true. At the same time, we haven't got another house. If we get thrown out of this one, we're in trouble.
The economic realities of contemporary corrections will, in the immediate future, force more changes in the prison system than reformers have been able to effect in a century.
I think a lot of the institutions can be closed. Not only can be closed, but should be closed.
Criminologist and consultant to California's Board of Corrections, Robert Keldgord.
My guess, and it's simply an educated guess, is that probably not more than 5% of the offender population in California or any other state for that matter need be imprisoned in a custody type facility.
The cost of imprisonment is going to be prohibitive, and I don't think the people are going to pay for it.
John O. Boone, Massachusetts Director of Corrections.
And right now in Massachusetts costs approximately $8,000 a year to keep one man in prison for a year. By 1976, the cost would be pretty close to $12,000 a year. Add to that the cost of keeping his wife on welfare while he's in prison, the cost, if he has any children, of an agency taking care of his children who might deviate while he's there, the cost of dropping out of school, and the cost when the wife might become deviant to make ends meet herself. This could mean that it'd be costing us some $25,000 or $30,000 a year to keep one man in prison for 1 year.
It costs between $15,000 and $20,000 per bed to build a new institution. Now, why do this when evidence demonstrates that for something like $600 per case per year, you can have probably more effective treatment in the community?
90% of the people that are in prison today can be treated outside with no danger at all to the community. Then we'll have small institutions to house the 10%, and we'll have community-based programs for the other 90%. And it's cheaper and it's much more effective. We will then be truly providing safe streets and combating crime.
People are saying that the prison system is a failure, is a way of, is tantamount to abandoning the whole society. The prison system is an integral part of our society, and I don't think it's all that big a failure. I think that there's certainly room for a lot of improvement. In fact, that's what we've been working on diligently in this department for some 25 years.
While California is working to improve prisons and reduce the number of commitments, in Massachusetts, where all state juvenile institutions have been closed, Dr. Jerome Miller is now working to eliminate temporary detention centers for young people.
We're going to be moving some kids out of Rosendale this afternoon.
How many?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure. Yeah, I think we've got to. We'll put some down at the Y, and we're going to try to get some into Camp Dorchester Monday.
Difficult cases, serious or disturbed offenders who may need to be isolated for their own or society's protection, are handled on an individual basis, usually in a closed psychiatric facility.
I don't view what we're doing as taking great risks, for instance. I feel very strongly that the greatest risk we've got is what we've been running, and that it's very important that we get out of this.
In Boston's Dorchester section, the Dare Residential Center, a halfway house in the predominantly black community.
I mean, I feel the best way is to help out the kids. You know, you can't help them out by locking them up. You just enforce the problem. And I think in a halfway house, especially a setting like this, you know, where you're not confined, you know, you have responsibilities. Everybody has responsibilities, you know. But a halfway house like this, you know, you have freedom. You have people around you. You meet people. And that's the thing, meeting people and talking and wrapping up problems.
Okay, what I wanted to focus on to staff was the problem that occurred over the weekend. I was Joey Colton and his brother. The problem was Joey didn't take the shoes back to his brother, you know, and I want to know why.
When I go back to face him, he's going to want to fight me, you know?
Yeah.
And there's just something about my brother, you know, like, I can't hit my brother, you know, because he's like, you know, he's like the only thing, you know, that I practically got in the world, you know? I mean, seeing that my mother and father is dead, he's like, you know, next closest kin, man.
No, what I say, man, I really think, man, that you should be busted for, man, because it's...
I should be busted for?
That's right, you have a problem, man. You have a problem of asking people to use it, and you don't bring them back. You damn right I think you should be busted for it.
Man, I don't think I should.
We have to take
those shoes back. Man, wait. You know, I don't think I should be busted for it, man, because it's a family problem.
Yep. Yeah, what about the problem? It's a problem.
That was between me and my brother.
That's right, until we brought the shoes back, it was between you and your brother.
Hey, I was looking out for you, buddy. I was looking out for you. Now you're taking a punkish attitude again.
That's what everybody's here for.
Yes, you are.
You're taking a cold-blooded punk attitude.
I feel if it's a family problem, man, I believe I can cope with it.
If you could cope with your family problem and stuff, you wouldn't be here, man.
Think that.
Why?
Why don't you go live with your brother then?
Because he doesn't like
me. If you respected him, you would have took him back.
Hey, man, I tell you right now, man, I'm not busting my butt for nobody, man.
We generally work intensively on immediacy problems, dealing with the problem as soon as it happened. We can get better results and positive reinforcement from both staff and residents. In other words, we don't like to deal with abstract. We want to deal mostly with the facts. And sometimes the only way to get to that is to go through a rap scene like that. And what the staff forgot, they forgot that this was a realistic thing to the kid.
I don't want it to be on the film.
Why don't you want to be on a film, Joey?
Because it moved me.
It moved you how? Because it was telling you the truth? Because it was reality and you couldn't face it?
Possibly, yes.
All right, isn't it also a possibility that they were trying to help you by showing you the respect for other people?
Let them see some of the negative aspect of you. Also let them see the positive aspect. But don't forget, what happened to you affects every other kid in the house. And you may give another kid a chance not to go to get into that same household. With your brother, with the streets, with your peers out there. When something like that comes down on me, you know, it'll be hard for me to face the streets, you know, to face up to my friends.
Well, you're worried about what those friends think, but those friends are not helping you. They're hindering you.
I might like to use another word, associates. And like Mrs. Youngblood said, I think if you will find that those associates that accept what happened, say, hey, man, you got guts to show the world what you feel down inside, or what your experiences have been. Not too many people can do that nowadays.
Let's go to pride. That's what we are dealing with, our pride, your pride, the young male's pride of today. This is why you were hurt. A little while back, what did I tell you? I love you. I love you as a human being. I'm part of the staff, and this staff loves you, and we're here to help you. We do love you. We are concerned. Those are important words. We are concerned for it here.
This kind of setting, more than 10 to 12 guys, is unique. This is the way you work with people on a very intense level, on a very concerned level, and it had to be part of your life. You have to make it part of your life, you know. It takes time, it takes dedication, it takes concern, it takes all the things in which you cannot provide.
The prison, the group home, the large reformatory, the halfway house, the state penitentiary, the community residential center, the new probation and parole. These are the choices: punishment, retribution, revenge, or understanding, concern for the individual, real efforts at socializing the criminal. If it is true that 50% of crime is committed by the young, and today a good part of this is drug-related, what can our attitude be? They are our children. As Dr. Miller has said, the more one gets to know and understand the offender, the less punitive one's attitude becomes. Today, with increased knowledge of motivations through the social and psychological sciences, we may be approaching fundamental changes in our attitudes toward the offender. For many, they may be hard to accept.
We have to protect our community and have to protect our society. You have got to protect the victim, and so often we've forgotten the victim in our society. Everything is for the youngster who's involved in trouble, and again, everything that we can do to help him do, but don't endanger our society, don't endanger our population in doing so.
My concern as a police officer, or one involved in juvenile work, is what is going to happen to the youngsters when they put them on the streets. I can see a tremendous police problem as a result of Dr. Miller's actions.
Dr. Miller believes that there is no such thing as punishment. He doesn't want to use it, just rehabilitation. I'm perhaps a little more conservative in these views, and I think sometimes a little punishment can help a child or help a youngster in the future.
To talk about punishment as a means of rehabilitation makes no sense at all. I think most of these large institutional settings don't deliver what they're supposed to. They do deliver a lot of harm. And I think we've got to begin to assume that much of the crime and delinquency problem is a product, if you will, of the system we've set up to treat. We should give the open settings a chance. We have to begin to question what we've been doing and to try some new modes. We'll have incidents, we'll have problems being out of training schools, but they won't be over the long haul of the consistency that they've been in the past.
Although this program has dealt primarily with young people, research studies show that community-based programs are having considerable success among adults as well. In California, among youthful offenders, recidivist rates, that is, convictions for new crimes by previous offenders, have been cut by 20% over the past 5 years. In Massachusetts, there are indications of even greater success. The products of the old system are too evident: crime in the community, despair in the prisons. the new programs offer hope to the community and the convicted. The Young Convicts, Prison in the Streets, has been a presentation of ABC News.